Hello everyone, and thank you for tuning in to today's webinar. We have a great presentation lined up for you today from Dechert, but before we get started, there are just a few general admin points to cover that I would like to mention for the attendees and press who are in attendance. Please use the online question tool to post any questions that you have, and we will share them with the speakers. Please share any technical difficulties in the questions tool, and a member of our admin team will be on hand to support you. The webinar recording and slides will be shared via email in the coming days. Without further ado, I'd like to hand over to our speakers to get us started.
Great, thank you. So welcome to our program, Thriving in the New Antitrust Paradigm. I'm Derek Winokur, a partner in Dechert's New York office, an M&A partner. I'm gonna serve as the moderator for this panel of antitrust experts. I'll let them introduce themselves.
Hello, everyone. I'm Laurence Bary, an antitrust partner in the Paris office of Dechert. I'm handling, in particular, merger reviews before the European Commission for international companies.
Hi, everyone. I'm Craig Falls. I'm an antitrust partner in Dechert's Washington, D.C. office. I spent half of my time doing merger clearance work and the other half the time doing exclusionary conduct litigation.
Hi, this is Jim Fishkin. I'm an antitrust partner based in Washington, D.C. and a former FTC attorney. My practice largely focuses on merger matters.
Hi, I'm Rani Habash. I'm an antitrust partner in the D.C. office, and my practice focuses largely on M&A transactions between strategic firms and counseling of firms on potential antitrust issues.
So let's dive right in. The title of this is you know, a new paradigm. So the question really is, what are we dealing with here? Is this just another typical look? The administration has changed. We've gone Republican back to Democrat, and you know, every time you switch administrations, you're going to have a tilt one way or the other. Or are we dealing with something more fundamental here?
Yeah, Derek. So my view is that we're dealing with something much more fundamental. We really are in a paradigm shift. Certainly the change of administration has accelerated the pace of change, but the calls for antitrust reform are bipartisan, and they preceded the current administration by about 5 years or so. You know, the prevailing view is that antitrust merger enforcement has not prevented consolidation in a lot of sectors of our economy, not just big tech, but also, as Senator Klobuchar would say, everything from coffins to cat food. So you know, traditional industries, not just cutting edge industries, but also, you know, across the board, we're seeing concentration. And the view from the enforcers is that, well, we need to revisit how we review mergers because we need to be a little bit more skeptical, as you can see in this quote on the slide here. And that also we should not be overly permissive towards towards merging parties, and that's manifested a number of ways. President Biden has asked the FTC and DOJ to review the merger guidelines, the guidelines that describe how mergers are analyzed, both in the vertical and the horizontal context. We've seen that the FTC has already withdrawn their support for the vertical merger guidelines that were issued only in 2020. DOJ has not withdrawn its support yet for those guidelines, but we expect DOJ to be reviewing the vertical merger guidelines along with the FTC, in addition to the horizontal guidelines. There's also a sort of new policy approach at the FTC that all tools need to be available to combat antitrust violations, and therefore a lot of policies that have been in place for many years that sort of set out a set of principles for the FTC to follow when using its powers have now been rescinded with the view that the FTC needs to have flexibility to do things in different, very different ways than it did in the past to be able to prevent antitrust violations. I think, you know, the big takeaway is, yeah, the rules of the game are changing. We'll get into some very specific ways they have already changed. But we're definitely in a new paradigm where the the merger review process and policy is different than what it has been in the past.
Yeah, and I think the interesting thing here is that as the agencies look for ways to potentially redo the way that they look at mergers and to potentially get more aggressive, they also are facing a lot of resource constraints at the same time. And so I think a lot of you who are in the M&A field know that there's just been an explosion of M&A activity. And if you look at the chart here on the slide, you can see that light blue line is 2021. That's the number of HSR filings each month in 2021 versus all the prior years from 2013 to 2020, you can see are about half as high. And so it's as they face this sort of burst of filings, they're also looking to potentially get more aggressive in enforcement. And, you know, they're going to have to choose their battles, I think, on which deals they can go after and which ones they can't.
Got it. And so given that this seems to be extending beyond merely an administrative change and more of a sea change, if you will, I wonder, Laurence, as we look across to Europe, are we seeing anything similar there? Same environment, same change?
Well, the first thing we're seeing that is similar, perhaps not as strong as Rani was just saying, but we do see a surge in the merger notifications to the European Commission, especially starting a bit later than in the US. But as from Q2 2021, we do see that surge very, very clearly. And it's coming at a time where the Commission is still largely working remotely, still facing a lot of challenges from the pandemic. And so we can expect delays and hurdles in Europe as well. The second thing that is important is, of course, Brexit, because although before most of the mergers that were going to the European Commission were not analyzed by the CMA in the UK, that will change. And so we see also a huge amount of additional work coming from the CMA. On the analysis itself, the one thing that the Commission seems to be focusing on right now is, as Craig was saying, they try to close what they perceive as an enforcement gap. It's probably narrower than in the US, but for example, in some sectors, especially life science and digital, they do perceive that the current system is too lenient and has allowed too many mergers to come through without enforcement. So that's definitely something we're seeing. On the other hand, you have member states that believe that the European Commission should be less strict regarding mergers with purely European champions. So we could see also a divergence here between international mergers and purely European mergers.
Got it. Interesting. So a little more subtle. So Jim, as we sit here today, just from a 30,000 foot level, what's the quick take here, and then we can dive in on a more granular basis.
Sure, Derek. All of the changes in how the agencies are enforcing the antitrust laws today are manageable by merging parties. And, you know, the parties should continue to do their deal activity. But the merging parties will need to adjust how they think about the various deal issues in their purchase agreements, such as, you know, what goes into the effort section, the conditions to close, and the termination date. Another thing is that the merging parties will also need to adjust how they conduct diligence on their deals and how they prepare for advocacy points to resolve potential issues that may arise from both FTC and DOJ staff during the initial waiting period and if the matter goes to a second request.
Got it. So then let's dive right in to our first topic, and that is, you know, one thing that we've all been hearing is that the FTC has been issuing these letters, issuing a letter, you know, the 30-day waiting period has expired, but you get a letter, and the letter says, hey guys, our investigation is not complete. So I guess the first question is, Jim, where are we seeing these letters? Are they being issued in all FTC cases? Some, how do you judge whether or not that's going to happen?
And what's going on here is, you know, the FTC is now issuing standard form warning letters. It's a policy that went into effect late July, early August of this year. And essentially, the letter is telling the parties, hey, your HSR waiting period is about to expire imminently. And, you know, the FTC is not going to issue second requests. But the FTC is telling the parties, hey, your proposed transaction, the investigation covering it remains open and ongoing. And these letters, which we refer to as warning letters, they tell the parties, hey, you are merging at your own risk, and the FTC could challenge your merger up to the time you decide to merge or potentially afterwards, after your deal is consummated. Now, the FTC today has not released any information regarding the number of warning letters that they've issued, but we know they are not issuing them for every filing that goes in, for every transaction that they're reviewing. The warning letters appear to be limited to two types of transactions. The first type are those where, you know, a proposed merger is under investigation. The merging parties have received questions from the staff. In many cases, they've received what are called access letters. They are responding during the initial waiting period. And, you know, basically the staff is telling the parties, hey, this is a very close call. Okay. And so the FTC decides not to issue a second request, but to notify the parties, hey, you are still under investigation, merge at your own risk. There also appears to be, and there is, a second group of letters that are going out. And these are parties receiving letters on the last day of their waiting period. They have never received or been contacted by the FTC in any way. And literally out of the blue on this last day, they are getting a warning letter. And, you know, sort of looking at these anecdotally, they basically fall into the category of either it's a very large size transaction, and it seems like they are in or limited to industries that are being targeted by the FTC, such as the healthcare industry. What is key, though, is that, again, the FTC is not issuing these in all transactions. We're not aware of warning letters going out where there's either no horizontal overlap or no vertical overlap or no potential related overlap in any way.
So I guess the next logical question is, since I got a chance, I'm going to get this letter. How do I look at the letter, Ronnie? Is how does this change the risk? What do I expect to happen?
So traditionally, the FTC and DOJ have always had the right to challenge consummated deals, even after they've done an HSR review, or if it's a non-reportable deal and the company's closed, the FTC and DOJ are not prohibited from investigating those deals. So some of this is more form over substance. I don't think that they're really changing any of the rights here. Just a couple of years ago, the DOJ had reviewed an HSR filing in the case of Parker Hannifin, and then after they had cleared it during the initial waiting period, went back several months later and got a consent order against the companies who had merged. And so, you know, they were not prohibited from doing that then, and they're not prohibited from doing it now. I think all that the letter means here is that, hey, we didn't issue a second request on this deal, but, you know, we're kind of giving you a warning that we were interested in this and it was a close call. But ultimately, we haven't seen, and we may not see for some time, some follow through on what that actually means for companies.
So Ronnie, have we? Does that mean we haven't seen? Has there been follow up letters that we've heard of, or the FTC has talked about issuing, saying, okay, now you're done and you're clear, or we need another time period? Is there any sense on that? Anything we're hearing?
Right. So there's no, you've never really gotten a letter when your deal is cleared as part of the HSR process. If the waiting period just expires on its own, you don't get a letter saying that the waiting period expired or anything like that. You know when it expired and that's it. So what's happening now is that these letters are coming on the very last day, often late in the day, on the last day of the waiting period. And they give you this sort of notification that your deal is under their view, yeah, even though they're letting you close.
So Laurence, how does this compare to what you're seeing in the EU? And specifically, there's a new Article 22 reform. How does that compare?
Yeah, it's interesting because historically the EU system is very different from what Rani was just describing. The system basically is that if you meet the turnover thresholds in Europe, you have to file for notification, and then you have a standstill obligation until you receive a formal letter from the Commission telling you it's okay to merge. And if you're below the thresholds, then you have to do nothing and you can merge at any time. Now, with the new interpretation that the European Commission is making of Article 22 of the merger regulation, the European Commission can ask the member states at any point in time to refer to them mergers that are below the threshold. So basically, it gives the European Commission the same rights as Rani was describing for the US agencies, which is to come back on a merger, even if it has been closed, and look at it and require divestment or things like that. So, of course, it changes things in Europe because now you have to choose either to close quickly and be done with it, but you take your own risk, exactly what the FTC is saying in these close at risk letters, or you wait to see whether you have a referral. But once the European Commission has accepted the referral, then it's different than in the US because you have the standstill obligation. And it's a good thing because you know what you have to do. It's a bad thing because it can last a very long time. On average, if you're going to phase two investigation, that's 15 months. So that's huge. And we also see that it can be used in the US, actually, in the Illumina Gray transaction in the life science sector. What the EC used, that new possibility to review the deal, issue a standstill obligation that allowed the US agency to drop their request for an interim order that was preventing the parties to close in the US because they were anywhere prevented to close by the European Commission. So that's an interesting convergence here.
Yeah, and it sounds like you're left with a tough decision. You have to decide whether you're going to take the risk or not. So look, given that we sort of have the same approach on both sides, how, and look, Craig, I turn to you, how are you seeing, what conversations are you having with buyers and sellers on how do you deal with this? How do you control or try to control the risk?
Right. So the nature of the risk is that, you know, once a buyer closes and the seller gets its money and goes away, the buyer is really taking all the risk then of that the deal will later be unwound or will be forced to sell the recently acquired company to some divestiture buyer in a post-consummation challenge. And so you can naturally see why buyers would then would not want to close when they receive a letter saying you can close, but you do so at the risk that we're going to continue the investigation and maybe bring an action later. But as Ronnie pointed out, we're not really seeing a whole lot of examples of the FTC opening up civil investigative demand type investigations after the HSR process has ended. We're not seeing, we haven't seen yet anyway, a situation in which the FTC allowed the waiting period to close and then brought a challenge later. So, you know, the risk is somewhat theoretical. It's real, but it's non-zero, but it's probably an asymmetric situation here, because the buyer is taking this risk that, yeah, maybe the FTC does something, you know, a couple months later, whereas the seller, you know, if it doesn't close now, well, you know, when will it close? When will this investigation be over? We don't know how long it will take for this investigation to run its course. So, you know, when these letters first came out, we saw situations in which buyers were putting into the conditions of to closing in the agreement that they had not received any such letter. You know, generally, we haven't really seen parties accepting that that arrangement, where the deal is basically hung up until investigation ends, because from the seller's point of view, they can't be on the hook for that long. They can't wait. And from the buyer's perspective too, there's some risk to them as well, waiting to close when the seller can find a reason now, you know, to walk away if you get to the end date. So really what you're seeing is either, you know, these are proposed, but not, I don't see them being accepted very often, this condition to closing approach, or you're seeing a hybrid in which there's some sort of, you know, running clock on it. So for example, you know, if you don't receive another communication from the FTC in 60 days, then you can force the buyer to close. Or if the FTC hasn't launched a CID in 30 days or 60 days, you can force the buyer to close. Or you know, at some other end of the spectrum, if the FTC hasn't actually challenged the deal in 30, 60 days, then you can force the parties to close. So that's more of what we're seeing. We're actually seeing very few agreements actually get modified for this risk. And where they do, there's sort of this, you know, short-term clock that gives the buyer a little bit more time to be able to confirm that there really isn't a material risk that it's going to face a post-consummation challenge. But there's not a whole lot of time built in there for the buyers.
Got it. And I guess also in some ways, I think we're waiting to see how it sounds like we're waiting to see how it plays out, you know, whether we do indeed see these investigations starting or, you know, and if they do, when, and do you get another letter? I got it. Okay, so let's move on to our second topic, prior approval requirements. This one's front and center. I think we all saw earlier this week the FTC issued a new policy statement talking about how they're reinvigorating a prior approval remedy for future deals. And so I think, Ronnie, maybe just to start at the base level, How does a prior approval remedy work? How does that affect the parties?
Sure. So the way that this will come up is if you have a transaction that goes under an FTC review, then at the end of that merger, after you've complied with the second request, or if you've gone to litigation, or if you reach a consent order with the agency, what they're saying is that they will impose a pre-approval sort of system on any future deals, at least for the next 10 years in the same industry that you are attempting an acquisition. And so what does a pre-approval actually mean? And how does that compare to the HSR process? So the HSR process is set up so you do the filing, and you know, typically the government has 30 days to review that filing and decide whether it wants to issue a second request and do a deeper investigation into the deal. So you have this fixed timeline. Now, with a pre-approval process, what the FTC is going to require is that if you have a deal, you notify them about it, and then they are not under any timeline to actually get back to you on whether you can close your deal or not. So unlike the HSR context, where the 30 days runs out, you're free to close your transaction under the law, under this type of consent order, this type of provision, which they intend to put into future consents, you would have to affirmatively go and get their approval. And they have said that, you know, they're very busy and they have limited resources, and that this will allow them to basically address it whenever they feel like it, which, you know, doesn't really put companies in a great situation if they are doing deals in the same industry as one where they've had a consent order in the past.
Interesting. So I guess, Jim, this sounds pretty significant. When are they saying they're going to potentially impose this remedy? And how?
Well, first, this really is very significant, and people really do need to be aware of this new policy, which in reality is a restoration of the way the FTC managed prior approval going back 25 years ago. So this was the policy in the 1980s through the mid-1990s. So under the new FTC policy statement, which was issued a Monday afternoon, the FTC is now going to routinely require parties subject to an order to obtain prior approval, as Ronnie described, from the FTC before they can close any future transaction in at least the relevant markets where the violation has occurred. As Ronnie said, that time period will be for 10 years. The FTC also stated that they are less likely to require or pursue a prior approval provision if the parties abandon their transaction prior to certifying substantial compliance with the second request. So in that case, you know, a party, you know, you're in the middle of a second request, you're gathering your documents, your information, and if at that point you decide to terminate or abandon the merger prior to certifying, the FTC is more likely to say, we're not going to then seek one of these orders requiring prior approval for future acquisitions. The FTC also said that where they've issued a complaint to block a merger, so they want to go out and seek a preliminary injunction in federal district court to stop the merger, the FTC said at that, and then the parties abandoned the merger. The FTC said they would make their decision about whether to impose the prior approval on what they referred to as a case-by-case basis. They outlined five criteria they would use in analyzing the imposition of the prior order in those situations. And that had to do with, you know, what's the nature of the transaction, the level of concentration in any specific area, the extent to which the transaction at issue increases concentration, whether the parties have a history of making a lot of acquisitions in the same markets or in related markets, and, you know, what's the evidence of these anti-competitive market conditions that are out there? Another area is, how broad is the area encompassed by the prior approval? And I said at the outset, it's at least the areas of harm alleged in the complaint. But we have already seen one example, and that also came out Monday on the DeVita matter, where the FTC alleged the harm, and this was a dialysis clinic merger, was in the greater Provo, Utah area. But the order or the prior approval area, they expanded that out to any acquisition in the state of Utah. So they've already got one example out there of where they're requiring a broader area or scope for seeking prior approval. And we can expect to see that going forward. We've got one example in place, and I would not be surprised if that sets a pattern going forward.
So, Jim, let me ask you a follow-up if I can. Just want to make sure I heard this right, because I heard you use the word routinely next to prior approvals, which is not a combination I love hearing. So just so I'm hearing you right, if you got two guys acquiring, doing a deal, and they're in the widget, industry, and going in, you know you guys are going to have a problem. And so you pre-agree, right, in your document that you're willing to divest a widget factory in, you know, jurisdiction X. And you go in with that, but you still nevertheless go through your whole HSR process with the FTC, you know, because you never know, right? Sometimes you get through and you go there and they say, nope, you're gonna divest that exact factory you said you're gonna divest. So kind of you went in there, you were ready to do it. Are they saying they're gonna impose, even in that circumstance where you kind of came prepackaged and said, we understand we have a problem?
And Derek, that's correct. In all of those examples, the example you gave or anything like that, the FTC will tack on in the consent agreement that specifically says you have to divest widget X in this area to a different buyer who then gets pre-approved by the FTC. They're putting in an order where it used to be called prior notice, but now that buyer is going to be subject to an order for the next decade saying, you can't buy another widget manufacturer in at least the area that you're divesting. But what everyone needs to realize is they could say it's not only in the area where that plant is located today, but it may be a broader area. You know, they could say, well, you know, the trucks distribute 250 miles, so we're going to make sure it's covering a broader geography.
Got it. So one more. So we agreed to divest a factory in jurisdiction X, but we purposely, the buyer has said, look, we're not gonna divest two factories. We're only gonna agree to one. We know there's another factory, it's in Y, but we don't want to divest that one. So the antitrust authorities come back, they say FTC comes back, you said you need to divest X and Y. Buyer says, well, the answer is no, seller, we're not going to do it, and we walk away from the deal. Did I hear you right that even we've now walked away from the deal? Is the FTC still going to come after us? Is there still a prior access risk here?
There certainly is a risk, and the FTC has laid out in their new policy statement that in those situations, they may still seek and demand a prior approval provision. In the example you've given, the parties have likely substantially complied with their second request, and the FTC has found a harm that's larger than what the parties believe it should be. And so they can't reach a settlement. They terminate the deal. But the FTC may say, well, you know, based on, you know, are there roll-ups in the industry? Is there evidence of high levels of concentration? These are the factors where they've kind of laid this out and they're going to look at it. But that is a potential issue. We do not have further guidance from the FTC or examples. I think we're going to have to wait and see, you know, if there are examples like that going forward. But it's certainly on the table and it should be considered when parties are considering a transaction and what they're baking into their purchase agreement and the obligations.
Okay, well, look, that, I mean, you know, kind of, Ronnie, as you had said and pointed out, if you're a buyer that is, let's say you're doing a roll-up strategy and you end up trying to get a deal done or getting a deal done, and you get a prior approval requirement in today's competitive market for a seller, sounds like, you know, As I think about it, all of a sudden you got to go in and disclose to your seller, hey, we may have the highest price, but if you choose us, we're not just a 30-day waiting period. We're a prior approval. And as you said, Ronnie, who knows how long it's going to take the FTC to give a prior approval. I mean, you got to get an affirmative yes as opposed to a, hey, we didn't pay attention to you. So kind of turning from that and what you said, Jim, which is, what are we doing in the contract? I guess, Craig, the question is to you, what do you see people doing to try to address this? And I know Monday was the report, although you guys have been whispering to me for a while that you heard about this. So what have we been seeing and what can we do?
Yeah, Derek, so I've already seen at least one example of parties building this into their agreement. But to set the stage, I do want to mention one other aspect of this. As Ronnie pointed out, there's when you're subject to a prior approval requirement, there's an issue of how long this is going to take for you to get that next approval on your next deal. That's going to impact your deal timing for sure, and that can impact how you compete in your next bid. But also, the FTC gets to say yes or no under this prior approval requirement. There's no requirement for the FTC to go to a court and prove its case. So you're pretty much at the, I'm sure the FTC will make principled decisions, but reasonable minds can differ on merger analysis. It's ultimately a speculation about what will happen in the future to competition if this deal goes through. And reasonable minds can differ on that. And now you're giving the FTC the final say on this. So you can imagine a scenario like the ones you've discussed where a buyer it sees an issue and it's willing to solve the issue, but it disagrees with the FTC on the scope of the issues. So the buyer said, I'll divest factory X, but I'm not divesting, factory Y. And so under a standard contract where you have a hell or high water provision, that buyer would have to agree to the prior approvals. And so the cost to the buyer of getting this deal done is maybe putting itself in a worse position than it was before it did the deal. So what will buyers do? Naturally, one thing you can do is you can, if you went to the one extreme, you'd say, I will divest this plant, but I will never agree to a prior approval provision. But that's not really going to work, because then if the FTC policy now is that every divestiture is going to come with a prior approval requirement, then the commitment to make a divestiture is kind of meaningless to the seller. So what will you do? You could carve it out and you could say, I will agree to a prior approval provision along with this divestiture, but only if it's limited to this one geographic area, this one product line, something like that. There's a drafting challenge there, because how do you draft that without sort of flagging for the FTC what you think is the antitrust issue, and separately, telling the FTC what your bottom line is, what you're contractually obligated to accept. So there's a little bit of a challenge with that. And the other challenge with it, as Jim pointed out, is say the FTC demands more and you walk away, well, the FTC can still come after you and subject you to a prior approval requirement, even though you're not contractually obligated to accept one. So under a typical hell or high water, you're going to proceed with your efforts all the way until an FTC decision. And the FTC says, when you do that, when you take us through the whole investigation through the end of a second request, that makes it more likely we're going to impose a prior approval requirement on you if you then abandon the transaction. So, another way you would have to deal with this is to build in almost the opposite of hell or high water and say, we're going to walk away if a second request issues, because there's no way as a buyer we're going to accept a prior approval requirement, or even the risk that the FTC demands a prior approval requirement from us if we abandon the transaction. So in that case, then you have to sort of make your good faith effort to your reasonable efforts under the covenant to advocate for clearance to try to resolve the problems. But if you see early in the second request process that the FTC is going to demand something you're not willing to give, then you can walk away. So that's where I see these agreements going, and it's going to be a case by case analysis to really understand. You have to work with your lawyers to really understand what's really the risk that you're going to be subject to a prior approval requirement that's broader in scope than what you're willing to accept. And that's going to take some analysis and some advocacy.
Wow. Yeah, I mean, on the one hand, from the buyer's perspective, if you're doing a deal and you know that you're willing to divest that one factory if the prior approval, and you know you have a widget concentration issue already in one jurisdiction, and you've accepted that, then the concept of a prior approval requirement of a, if you were to buy another widget factory in that exact same jurisdiction, you could imagine getting comfortable with that concept. And yeah, the seller needs to be careful, and we need to draft the provision carefully. And now, instead of coming to you guys for one provision on what we divest, there's going to be two exceptions talking about the prior approval. But all that depends on, and we don't have it yet. And Jim, you're pointing out that in the DeVita case, the prior approval was not drawn as narrowly. But the wild card to me for the buyer seems to be that when you go in, when you decide what you're willing to divest, you're going to have to think long and hard about what you're not willing to divest. Because even if you walk away from the deal, it used to be you could cabin your risk. I'm a buyer. I'll do this deal. I'll divest this asset. I'll even agree to a prior approval in this area. But if they want more than that, I'm going to walk from the deal. And sure, I'll have deal costs. Maybe I'll have a break fee. But that's my risk. And it sounds like sort of the new wild card here is you're tossing up or bringing to the attention of the FTC the potential. They've now noticed they think there's two areas where you shouldn't buy things. And they're going to come in and try to get a prior approval, maybe, on you in that additional jurisdiction, which is a new risk. And you know, it's going to be interesting and highly dependent to see what the FTC actually does. Do they really go ahead and do that? Or is this more of a threat? And how broadly they draw that? One last thing, Craig. I recall seeing in the memo that they talked about imposing this on divestiture buyers as well. Did I get that right?
Yeah, that's absolutely right. So a divestiture buyer who is buying assets is now subject to prior approvals if it sells the acquired assets within 10 years. Now, assets aren't always kept insulated. They're going to be integrated into the buyer's other assets. So the question is, does this actually prevent the divestiture buyer from selling other assets in the future for the next 10 years because of the integration? And then separately, you can think of the impact here being that it's already difficult to find a divestiture buyer. You've already got to sell assets below market value when you're in a divestiture in most cases. And now this divestiture buyer is subject to a limitation on what it can do with those assets for 10 years. Will that make it even more difficult to find a divestiture buyer who's, willing to pay anything to acquire the divested assets?
And I should just quickly drop in, this is a new policy that there is no prior history of. At most, the FTC in certain cases with certain upfront buyers had like a 3-year restriction. You couldn't, flip the assets without prior approval. But to put this in for all divestor buyers that you cannot turn around and sell in year 8 or 9 or whatever it may be, these assets without prior approval, that is a significant change.
Yeah. And it probably just worth noting as I sit here and think about it, that it's one thing when you're getting a consent order and the FTC is telling you, you got to sign this to do your deal. If you've walked away from a deal and they decide to come after you, I'm assuming at that point, Craig, this is not an FTC. I mean, the FTC has to go to court and get an order put on you. So you got to get both the FTC and they have to come in. You get a chance to present your case, I presume.
Yeah, I mean, if the FTC can get this to an administrative court, so this is their home court. but yes, they have to go prove that this remedy is appropriate in this circumstance.
So Laurence, let me turn to the EU and ask you any corollaries here.
That's actually a fascinating discussion to listen to for a European lawyer, because we always think the European Commission is tougher and has stricter powers than the US agencies. But no, that's not something that the Commission can require as a remedy. Never. You cannot require a remedy that is on another transaction. And that's where really the FTC is really putting something new in the bargain here. But it's still a perceived enforcement gap in Europe. And the only thing that the European Commission is trying to do that looks a bit like this right now is trying to impose through the Digital Market Act, the DMA, which is currently under review by the European Parliament. They're trying to include an obligation to notify any concentration, whether it's reportable anywhere in Europe or in the world, notify any concentration to the European Commission when it's an acquisition by a platform, any of the platform that will be subject to the Digital Market Act, with the idea, of course, that right now, in those sectors where our concentration is high and where startups are being acquired by powerful players, thresholds are meaningless and they should review every single transaction. We do not know yet whether this will be actually adopted by the European Parliament and the Council, but that's the direction they are going in, keeping in mind that they cannot use remedies, so they have to find another way.
Okay, thank you. So let's move on to our final topic, our final prepared topic, which deals with the scope of investigations. I've read a bunch of press articles that have talked about that antitrust enforcers, there are now questions people are getting from antitrust authorities in the U.S. on labor, unionization, even ESG. I have to admit, these are not areas that I have typically associated with an antitrust analysis. So, Jim, what are we experiencing here?
Yeah, and this is a shift from the typical consumer welfare standard questions, which are very focused on whether consumers may be facing higher prices, lower quality. Those are the traditional issues. So in addition to those issues, the parties to a merger need to be prepared to answer additional questions. And so number one on the list we are seeing now a stronger focus on whether the proposed merger may impact workers and labor markets, not just consumers. So what if the merger, for example, is between the two largest employers in an area? Could the impact have some effect on wages for those various skilled employees? Do any of the workers at the merged firms have non-compete provisions in their employment contracts that prevent them from working for another firm if they feel like, wow, they can't move up, their wages aren't going up or as high as they'd like them to go? The FTC is also seeking questions about whether or how many employees are in unions and by what category. So for example, is anyone who's working for a union going to potentially lose their job because of a merger? Other areas that we're seeing the FTC focus on, for example, include whether the merger may have effects on disadvantaged or marginalized communities. And, you know, you could see different scenarios where the merger could impact, you know, certain neighborhoods, areas, groups of people, whatever those may be. And so, you know, these areas are being looked at carefully. A third category is whether the merger may have adverse impacts on smaller independent businesses or what the FTC in their leadership statements refer to as quote unquote honest businesses. So are those businesses going to be adversely harmed? And finally, there is some focus on social issues such as ESG or even potentially climate issues. So the FTC is now throwing out, to some extent, Department of Justice, a lot of additional areas of concern or potential concern beyond the standard focus on consumers.
Got it. So I guess, Ronnie, let me just turn to you. What does this mean as we counsel buyers and sellers and they think about, you know, getting into a deal and how you approach it and how you approach diligence?
So I think one thing is that the FTC in particular seems to be thinking about new theories that need to be explored. And so, you know, we've always had horizontal deals between direct competitors, and I think everyone understands why the agencies are interested in those. But I think we're likely to see some more novel theories. So not only vertical deals, which have also seen increased interest or at least increased discussion in recent years, but also diagonal deals, which is where you may be acquiring not a company within your own supply chain, but a company within someone else's supply chain and potentially crippling a competitor. And then cross-market issues as well. Like, are there other products in a company's portfolio that sort of interact in a way with the target company because that you may be able to use those two together to achieve some sort of anti-competitive harm? So I think the biggest thing is that companies need to really think about more creative theories of harm besides just, do I compete with this other company or not? Because I think that question is always asked, but we may start to see some more exotic theories in the future.
And to add to that, I think, you know, one, it's important to get your antitrust counsel involved early so you can identify, even though you don't have a direct horizontal competitive overlap, whether there are other issues that might come up in the investigation. But also get them involved early because the way you write about your deal rationale is particularly important now. You know, to give you a couple examples, there's a concern recently about the supply chain disruptions in the economy. So and sort of the resiliency of businesses to deal with things like this. So if you're you know, some of your synergies of your deal are combining production into one plant, you know, that may not be as attractive of a synergy anymore. In fact, may be a flag for enforcers who are reviewing your deal. You know, looking at comparing prices that you're paying to common suppliers and saying we're going to be able to lower our prices because we'll get the better terms when we merge. Well, that can flag a monopsony, you know, buy side market power issue, as opposed to being a synergy that in the past may have been something you would point to say this is why you should allow the deal. So you know, under this new paradigm where we're not just concerned about the allocation of resources in our economy for maximum efficiency, instead we're worried about power imbalances between all these entities that live in an ecosystem around a business, whether it's laborers or suppliers or the environment. In this world, you need to change how you look at your deal rationale, what will be viewed favorably and what would instead raise a flag.
Yeah. And sort of top of that list would be, in a lot of mergers historically, you know, labor cost savings were a big synergy. And today that may be viewed potentially as a harm to workers.
Laurence, are we seeing a similar increase in scope in investigations in the EU?
Not really, but it's probably because most of what is starting to be taken into account in the US right now was already taken into account by the European Commission before that. For example, vertical diagonal considerations, monopsony, minority interest in competitors, coordination between parent companies, all these subjects are already been targeted by the European Commission, sometimes in very early cases. So it's already covered by the guidelines of the European Commission. And I think it gives us an interesting insight, actually, into what the US agency might look at in the future. And of course, we have some experience in Europe on how to deal with that. It doesn't mean that the US agencies will take the same approach. But I think, again, we do see a convergence here that is very, very important.
All right, thank you. So look, that's the end of our prepared portion of this presentation. I think now we'll turn to, I think we have a couple minutes left. We can turn to some questions. The first one that I see here says, we've been talking a lot about the FTC. Are we seeing the same things coming from the DOJ? So, Jim, let me first turn to you on that, and then, you know, I'll open it up and anyone else wants to talk about it.
We have not yet seen the same changes at the Antitrust Division at the Department of Justice as we are seeing at the FTC. I think that's principally because the president's nominee to be the Assistant Attorney General, Jonathan Cantor, is waiting for a Senate confirmation vote, which potentially could come very shortly. That's why we're seeing that the Antitrust Division did not withdraw the vertical merger guidelines. They are not issuing warning letters, and they generally are not making various policy statements and the like. I think we're going to see a lot of similarity and symmetry between the agencies going forward once the new Assistant Attorney General gets confirmed. And that will lead to less divergence, particularly as the agencies work on issuing new horizontal and vertical merger guidelines.
Yeah, I'd add to that that, you know, the things that the FTC is doing now are the results of things that the White House has specifically requested the FTC to do. So the White House has also set up this new competition council that covers the FTC, DOJ, and many other branches of the executive or departments of the executive branch that are all working together to coordinate their efforts on competition issues and antitrust issues. And so you would expect, of course, the DOJ to do everything the FTC is doing, and there to be convergence. In addition, there's a political risk if the DOJ and FTC are maintain divergence over a long period of time, as there have been bills in the past in the Senate looking to sort of disband the FTC and bring it under the DOJ's jurisdiction, and so I would fully expect there to be convergence as soon as the DOJ appointee gets approved.
Got it. So let me, here's another question we have. This is a balancing question. Let me turn to Ronnie on this one. If what you have is an acquisition that substantially improves the labor market, right? It's gonna have new hires, increased benefits, positive impact on a marginalized community, but poses an anti-competitive effect under a traditional market analysis. Does the positive labor market outweigh the antitrust negative? How do we think the FTC and soon the DOJ are going to balance those?
It's a good question. I think the analysis is always going to start with competition. And so, you know, if a deal is bad for competition, then I don't see some of these, you know, potential labor benefits as overcoming sort of any competition concerns. And I think the reason for that is it seems like these are more reasons to perhaps block a merger than they are to enable a merger. So if a deal is hurting competition, then I don't think that, you know, maybe a benefit to minority communities or a benefit to labor markets and things is going to save it.
Okay. Let me ask one more. This says the FTC has some targeted industries, and we gave an example of healthcare. What other industries do we think the FTC are looking at as targeted? currently.
And Derek, I can take this one real quick and then someone else can step in. But the a couple of months ago, they did announce some targeted areas for enforcement. So they had identified, I think, what they called repeat offenders. They identified tech companies and tech platforms. They identified healthcare. I don't think that that's an exhaustive list. I think that that was what they were focused on at the time. But you know, if you have, let's say, a company that's in the energy field, and that company, you know, gas prices are going up, and there's concern about gas prices, you know, it's possible that you could see the FTC expand what it considers to be key industries to cover new ones. So they haven't given an exact list, but they didn't identify some of those areas before. And I think they'll continue to add to it.
And I'll just quickly throw in one other industry is agriculture, which was identified by the president. Portions of the ag industry, which is very broad from farm to table, cover DOJ products. Others in the food lineup are reviewed by the FTC. So I would throw those out on the table.
Great. Okay. I think, look, we've run over, and I think I think that's it. So I want to thank everybody for joining us, and thank our panelists. That was great. Thanks so much.
Thank you all.
Thanks.